Hello, everyone, and welcome back to a comeback episode of the Untitled Marvel Project. I'm your infected host, Tanner Dykstra. I'm joined by my infected co-hosts, Abram Buhner, and not quite infected, Tucker Hazel. We are today talking about the long-awaited episode of UMP. We're finally getting around to talking about Avengers Infinity War. But before we get into it, I want you to like this video. I want you to comment on this video. I want you to go down to that little description, you know, the one under the video, in there. Is a link to join our Discord. There, you can talk about games. You can talk about movies. You can talk about a plethora of other things. Whatever you damn well please. And we'll be there to talk with you. So
we'll talk back to you.
A conversation, I think, some call it.
Yeah, but it's just a round of talking back. You know, you talk, I talk back, you talk back, boom.
All right.
Bada bing, bada boom.
And Tucker, I like the sound of that, so let's do that, but with Avengers Infinity War. And I want to start with... Abram Buhner.
Okay, here's the situation, right?
Okay.
If it wasn't clear from the intro, I'm sick, Tanner's sick. Different illnesses, but nonetheless, here I am, right? I'm wasting away in my fucking mortal frame in bed for the last couple days, right?
Uh-huh.
Was there a movie about that? The mortal frames?
You're thinking of the mortal engines.
We don't have time to get sidetracked.
And I get reminded that, hey, we're doing the Untitled Marvel Project, so I have to flick on this little film called Infinity War, right?
Uh-huh.
And for those, I believe, 2 hours and 31 minutes about, I felt as fit as a fiddle.
Yeah.
Because this is a great fucking movie. Here's the situation about Infinity War. When I saw it for the first time, I saw it opening night on an enormous screen, and I was in one of the front rows with a bunch of my friends for a birthday. And I remember coming into the side of it thinking, yeah, I like that. I don't really get the hype, I suppose. And I think it might have been the sort of thing where it was just built up so much in my head that Infinity War couldn't have possibly been what I wanted it to be.
Yeah.
And then I remember rewatching it ahead of Endgame and thinking, I'm a fucking idiot. This movie's awesome. And I largely feel that way now. It really, and because these movies are made by like a team of people in the boardroom, it makes sense. But Infinity War feels chemically engineered to be the coolest movie possible. And I think it is for like 90% of the runtime. I do think the movie is too long. Mm. I think that you could trim this down a little bit. And I'm indifferent towards Thanos in some ways that we can talk about. Mm. But on the whole, I really think Infinity War is just a badass movie. It's just badass. I really think it's excellent.
Tucker Hazel.
Yeah, I mean... I don't think any of us are going to be completely off mark on this point. You know, usually one of us, at least one of us, is wrong.
Right.
I just want to put that out
oh,
there.
Oh, sure. Okay.
But this time I think we're all right. Because, this movie's badass. I mean, I've seen this movie like 6 times. This movie came out, it feels so weird that this movie actually only came out for a little over 4 years ago. It feels like a decade ago in my mental mind, because this was probably one of the most defining moments of our high school age culture. Mm-hmm. The fact that this movie came out and had the spoilers that it did and had the hype building up to it that it did, and that it came out as good as it did, I think is what really blows me away here. Is the interconnected storytelling of the MCU is, for me, one of the great strengths of it. And I think it feels like it's a different kind of storytelling that I don't feel gets enough praise. Of course, these movies make a gazillion dollars. It's like the 10th highest grossing movie of all time.
Mm-hmm.
These movies get a lot. But in terms of the quality of storytelling, I think that Infinity War and following up Civil War and then leading into Endgame really proved to me that there's something special here about taking disparate tones and disparate directors and all these characters and all these actors and storylines and putting them into one core thing that makes it all feel so coherent, yet moving it all forward in a really compelling way that it just... I think this movie is very special. I think it's a defining moment in cinematic history, and I think it's top-tier Marvel. I think it's top-tier film. I think it's top-tier Marvel. I love this film.
Yeah, absolutely. Tucker, as you said, we're all correct on this one.
Finally!
Because Infinity War is a banger. It's a certified banger. I don't know what else to say, really, but of course we have a lot more to say because there's a lot of stuff that goes on in this movie.
Yeah.
I think that's the greatest strength of this film, is that it has so much to do. I mean, we have, you know, Civil War was like the big crossover, but this was really like the culmination of what Tucker was talking about, like the interconnected storytelling. Marvel, you know, flexing their muscles up there on the world stage, saying this is what we are capable of. You know, making the 10th highest grossing movie of all time, bringing together all these characters.
That was just an approximation, by the way. I don't know.
Okay. It's up there. It's up there for sure. Actually, didn't Top Gun beat it? So it would be number 7 now?
That's for domestic only.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Regardless, we're bringing together all these characters that the public loves so much, and we balance it out so well. That's what really stuck out to me in this movie. Is I was watching along, this is going along at a clip. I'm like, I love all these characters. I love the pairings that they come up with for this movie. And then we switch to a different group of characters. I'm like, oh, that's right. We have these characters here. I also love this. And that's the real strength of Infinity War.
I think that framing the Infinity War discussion in retrospect around something different is actually quite interesting. And that, to me, is the plot and the framing of this film. Watching this, now we kind of knew how Infinity War is going to end as we were watching for that first time, right? You have an understanding. But revisiting the film, knowing that everybody fucking loses and half of them evaporate into sand or smoke or whatever the hell they evaporate into, I think puts this movie in a really interesting and desperate lens. And I think that, to me, is a large part of why it's so successful. As you're saying, Tanner, we have all these really interesting and fun character moments where we get these dynamics of crossovers that felt, even though they're all Marvel characters, they feel really wacky and fun. Like getting Stephen Strange and Tony Stark going and butting heads with each other. And this sort of context of, oh shit, we gotta collaborate because the world's gonna end. When we get the Guardians and Thor smacks onto the windshield, the Milano. These are great moments. And it's fun, fan service-y, interesting stuff that services the narrative. But it's made so much more interesting by the fact that you know that everybody here is fucked. And I think that in a franchise that is so safe in so much of its storytelling, it is really cool to hinge a movie of this scale, of this importance, around a major loss. I think that that really puts all of this character stuff in a different and cooler light than if at the end, at the very last second, they eke out a win over Thanos, right?
Yeah.
The fact that it all goes to hell makes, I think, every moment here more impactful and more desperate than it would have been otherwise.
Yeah, and I think it's the pacing and the condensed amount of time that this film takes place over that really heightens that. This film is a scramble. No one knows exactly what's happening. No one person is talking to everyone else. There is not a lot of core collaboration in that regard. And everyone is trying to figure out the information. Oh, shit, where's Thanos? Where's this? What's going on? Who can we run to in this last moment of desperation? And even with our past struggles, okay, we need to put that aside because if we do not overcome this, we will all, or half of all people will die. And like the idea of putting the characters that we know under such a dark desperation, I think is why this movie shines so brightly for me in terms of its writing, is I think it's the best example of the drama of the MCU. I think this film has some of the best serious dramatic moments, helped immensely by an incredible score and great performances across the board. But the intense drama, and also it has some of the best comedy. I think the fact that this movie elevates both of those to the tippy top of what they've been, how they've been done in this long running series, is impressive. But it all hinges around the fact that they're placed into a scenario that is just unimaginable, and they're all trying to figure it out as it comes along to them.
Yeah, I think Tucker's right. You bring up a good point, Tucker, about our heroes are scattered. With the, you know, they're scrambling to come together to understand this threat of Thanos is coming. What does that mean? Who is this? What are the Infinity Stones? What's going on? And these seeds have been planted, of course, through the previous 18 movies.
Yeah.
Now we're all coming to fruition. And Abram, you threw in a snide comment about how maybe you want to talk about Thanos a little bit. But I think that that's part of the reason why Thanos is such a compelling villain for this film, is that he is on like an unstoppable death march. Okay, I mean our characters are like always trying to catch up to him, predict what his next move is going to be, and he always wins in each of these scenarios because he is so unstoppable, and because, you know, our heroes are scattered like they are, and you know they can only defeat him when they actually finally come together in the ultimate battle in Avengers Endgame, which, well, I'm sure we're all excited to get to. But what we get right here is an establishment. We're finally getting Thanos. He looks great. Josh Brolin is fantastic as he grumbles out these lines and as he waxes poetic about, you know, destiny and what it means, how he is the one morally true, correct, and straight arrow in the universe of chaos. And he's like, you know, a lot of people are going to hate me, but this is what I need to do. His lines are all about how these heroes are fighting for a futile idea of saving everyone. And obviously that comes around when he wins in the end. Half of the universe is decimated, even though decimated means 10%. But hey, who's gonna call out what Thanos does here?
I will.
Okay.
Here's my feeling, right? I think that many different thoughts about Thanos, right? Uh-huh. The first one I want to praise the film on is how Thanos looks. I was recently rewatching the excellent first three Pirates of the Caribbean movies. Actually, excellent is too strong a word. The very cool first three Pirates of the Caribbean movies. And I said there, and I still maintain, that Davy Jones is the best looking CGI character that's ever been put to screen ever. I think it's crazy what they did there. And then I think it's the Transformers. And then it's probably something from Star Wars because I'm biased. Uh-huh. But then I think it's Thanos. I think that Thanos really does feel quite believable on screen, as does all of the, well, not all of them, but I would say 95% of the visual effects in this film.
Yeah.
We can talk about those outliers when we get to the Wakanda battle.
Yes.
But I think that I feel like there's a weight to Thanos. And it's translated very early on when he's fighting Hulk and he just starts beating the shit out of him. Mm-hmm. He's doing combos on the Hulk like it's Marvel versus Capcom. And it's very, very cool. We get a sense of his presence and his threat very quickly, and the film never really lets up on that front. I think that a lot of sort of the fear of Thanos is built by our characters, by these comments of he's like one stone away from being unstoppable. And he seems pretty unstoppable without all those stones, right?
Yeah.
So it's that feeling. It's what sort of the audience takes away from how our heroes are feeling that makes him seem so domineering, because he is. But I just think that his motivation is stupid. I have never been able to get behind the whole Thanos. The only way Thanos can think to solve all of this is by killing half of everybody. Like, in the context of the film's logic, it makes sense. And I think that the scene when he goes to Gamora's planet and we get this sequence of him lining up half of people, you pick a side and either you're going to live or you're going to die. He doesn't care, but you got to pick one of these two sides. And then half people get executed. I think it's a very good sequence. And when we're hearing him talk about his home planet and how it got overpopulated and then nobody knew a happy life and then half the people are gone and everybody woke up knowing full stomachs. I get it. I get what they're saying. But as an audience member, I'm just saying they're like, there's nothing else you could do. And I get that at a certain point I have to suspend my disbelief. And I understand that.
Yeah.
But it's like this super smart, super talented, badass Thanos can do anything at the snap of his fingers, and he's going to come in here and he's going to wipe out half of the people. I'm not going to come in here and actually could have made twice the number of resources so everybody could be happy. That's an equally hokey solution to me. But I just think like, you just want a reason for the villain to destroy half of the universe. And so it never reaches that level for me of resonance of, okay, it makes sense that he wants to do this. This is the way to preserve humanity and other species, futures and existences. He feels badass. He feels powerful, but I just don't like that motivation.
I think that's interesting because I'm on the train with you for a little bit, but then I don't even know if you're on the train after a certain point because... Or maybe you're in a different car. Maybe you're like hanging off the back of the caboose by one arm, waving in the wind. But the idea that Thanos is not thinking in the logical way of creating more resources or whatever answer you think might be better is where I'm a little bit confused on your question, because I think his motivations make a lot of sense when you think about where they came from. Clearly, this is a person, a character that is already has genocidal tendencies. All right. Okay. I don't think that's up for debate here, but that he's taking what he believes works on a small scale and trying to just apply that on a large scale. And you think of someone who has those genocidal roots, it's just extrapolating out to the entire universe. And he's very resolute in his goal in that way. And because it does have that element of morality to it, is that he believes this is the moral thing to do. He knows that if he goes through with this, everyone else will have clear skies and full bellies, there is that element of believability to where, you know, controversial, but I wouldn't do what Thanos did. But the track record of his thought process and the morality behind it, I think, makes us the most believable comic book, ridiculous, over-the-top bullshit that I've ever experienced, especially with the stakes that it ends up having in the end.
I mean, I get where you're coming from, and like I said, I don't think the solution is he should have snapped his fingers and made two of everything so everybody could be happy.
Of course,
I just, like, you're never going to get me to empathize with Thanos. You're never going to show the scene of him talking to young Gamora, and she's like, what did it cost? And he says everything, and me really care. Because ultimately, he's killing half of all the people that exist. And I don't really, it doesn't really track with me that, you know, he's got some sort of internal morality, or like, I don't feel sad when he kills Gamora. I don't feel sad when he snaps his fingers. Because I just think that it is so crazy what he's doing. He's killing one out of every two people that exist in the entire universe.
That's half of BLB.
That is half of BLB.
Uh-huh.
No, it's half the BLB subscribers, too.
That's
I get even less views.
And again, I think that Thanos is a very imposing character. So I'm not taken out of the movie, really. But I just don't buy it when the film tries to humanize him or make me empathize with Thanos. Because I just can't, given what he's doing.
Well, yeah, I don't necessarily think the movie is trying to humanize him. I guess that's where I differ on my reading of Thanos as a villain, is that he's dogmatic, he is utilitarian, he is fascistic, for sure, and that's why he's, you know...
What I'm looking for in a husband.
That's why he is set on that path of, you know, snapping his fingers, killing half the universe.
Sure.
And, of course, you know, I come back to this thing again of, I think Thanos is... You know, manipulative, and sure, he might have we come to learn that he has true love for Gamora, but you know, it might be the case that, you know, all sorts of abusive relationships, the abuser does have a care for the person they're abusing, but it doesn't, you know, it doesn't make them a good person. I would say, just because they have love in their heart for something, it still makes them a genocidal maniac who is willing to kill his own daughter for his dogmatic ends.
Yeah, here's the thing. I think that we're thinking about Marvel villains. Most of them, complete horse donkey pucky shit. Fuck. Okay? I know, part of my French. Uh-huh. Might be a little overkill, but yeah. I made it. Every fiber of my being.
Uh-huh.
But I think what makes a compelling villain is that if they have a compelling dramatic stakes for our heroes, and our heroes feel the impact of what's going on, and if they believe in what they're doing. I think the believability factor between... us, the humble little American boys in the 21st century, mm-hmm. the mental connection to God-killing maniac Thanos, I don't think that connection is necessary for a villain to be incredibly compelling. I think if you combine them being passionately resolute and believing genuinely in what they're doing, which I think, alongside, like, Killmonger, Thanos is easily one of the best examples I can think of in cinema, of him believing in what he's doing and believing that it's right and putting forth like constant explanations of this is why I'm doing it and why I believe this. And he does have that genuine love for Gamora, as we find out. I think that combined with the off the charts stakes, like maybe the highest stakes ever witnessed on film, off the heat death of the entire universe, makes it like, I really just don't see why there needs to be this third leg to balance it out.
I think what it comes down to is I just think that the movie is too long, and that at a certain point, this is going to make me sound like a massive fucking hypocrite giving what I say in half of these reviews.
Uh-huh.
Just don't spend so much time trying to rationalize what Thanos is doing, I suppose.
Hmm.
What I think about is like Darkseid in a film that we all love equally, mm-hmm. Zack Snyder's Justice League. The difference between Thanos and Darkseid is that Zack Snyder didn't care about trying to make Darkseid anything more than a guy who wants the mother boxes to just terraform Earth, right?
Also, he's never a villain in one of the movies.
Who am I thinking of? You know who I'm thinking of. Apocalypse.
No. You're Darkseid. Your DC is Darkseid, but he's never the main villain of any of the movies.
Who's the big fucking guy in this thing?
Steppenwolf.
They're all the same.
In the Snyder Cut, though, Steppenwolf is working for Darkseid.
Right. Yeah, but right. I don't think that makes him the main villain, but I digress.
Point being, when I think about Thanos, Thanos is functionally the same as Steppenwolf to me. give my heroes a reason to coalesce under threat and take him out. What I like about Killmonger is that Killmonger's motivations make sense and they're part of this interesting, larger thematic statement about the movie. I don't think the Russo brothers are trying to tell me that we've got an overpopulation problem on Earth. I really don't think that there's any thematic material to this film at all.
In fact, they're probably glad that there's no overpopulation problem because that got them more tickets.
Right.
Money, baby.
But what it just comes down to me is like, I just don't care. And it's a very subjective problem, I recognize.
Yes.
But I just don't think that that time is well spent when you're trying to make me understand why Thanos wants to just kill people at every other person at random. If you wanted to just say Thanos wants the Infinity Stones because he wants to control the universe, it's easier to control the universe when there's half as many people. That to me makes as much sense as Thanos thinking, man, goddamn, there's not enough resources on all the planets that exist all over the universe and every single ecological society everywhere and that exists. So I want to snap half of them away. Just to me feels like convolution for the sake of trying to write a motivation into a character that ultimately, in the sake of a big hokey comic book movie, is not where I want that focus to be because it just rings hollow. We see a villain like Killmonger who is grounded and is interesting and has something going on. Thanos, to me, I just want him to be there so we can fight him. Because anything else to me, in the context of what they try to write, just feels very silly. I think his motivation is very silly.
Yeah. Tucker, go
here's
ahead.
What I said. I can use this transition to something that I think we can branch out into much more aspects of the film. I think the reason why it's very important that they balance his screen time and dialogue and presence as they did, it's not only because I think it gives a lot more for Josh Brolin to do, and I'm very glad that they have such an amazing actor portraying a villain that has such a presence, but it gives him a chance to have a lot more dialogue. And I think that the dialogue in this film is another reason of why it works so well, is you're getting a number of sequences of Thanos speaking to Gamora, waxing poetic about all these things, and it just gives you chances to see great performances and great dialogue. And that, I think, is a pervasive across the entire film. It's because, Tanner, what you said initially, where we're going to start with this, is our favorite characters. I think that this film has some of the best dialogue and character emotional moments for almost every part of the cast. Of course, there are exceptions. It's such a huge cast. There has to be some
people get sidelined. It's necessary for this kind of movie.
But for me, I think the highlight of this movie is, and you know, people say, oh, Ragnarok was really what changed Thor. But no, I think it's Infinity War that gave him the dramatic weight that really makes him feel like much more of a realized and human character. It's the actualization of the loss that he felt across all the films that he's been in, but especially Ragnarok, to where you get the emotional weight through the incredible dialogue scene, which is portrayed by easily the best performance that I think maybe Chris Hemsworth has ever given as Thor.
Haven't seen Spider-Head.
God damn it, no, I haven't. Haven't seen Extraction.
Tucker, thank you for reading my mind, because Thor is easily, far and away, the best character in Avengers Infinity War. Hemsworth turns in an all-timer performance. I mean, the stuff with him in the Guardians is not only funny, but the dialogue between him and Rocket progresses both of their arcs so well. I mean, you have Thor obviously talking about he's literally lost everything, but he knows that people look up to him as this sort of hero, and he's like, hey, what else do I have to lose? I have to win. What else do I have to lose? I have to win. All these other things, you know what I mean? And then Rocket, he's a bit more understated in the film, I think, but I love the moment when him and Thor are about to depart in the pod to go to Nidavellir, and Chris Pratt is, or Star-Lord is like, hey, I know that you're only doing this to get away from Thanos. And he's like, hey, you better watch it because you're talking to your captain. But it's obvious that he's doing that to bring Groot with him because he knows that, you know, this is going to be the least dangerous path to put Groot on. And that is, you know, the connection that Rocket and Groot have, of course, but it is also, you know, sort of Rocket working behind the scenes and doing his own mental calculations to protect the ones that he loves. And I think that's something that is carried over in a lot of his appearances.
Now, Tanner, I think this is why you're such an academically minded young boy.
Oh, okay.
Because I think you're very good at reading into things that might not be there.
Oh,
I personally didn't really get that whole Groot-Rocket thing. I like it. I think you could write a really nice intro, three body paragraphs, conclusion essay about it. But nonetheless, even though I don't necessarily know if that's in the film, I think you're still totally right. I love Thor and I love Rocket and Groot and I love this whole adventure they went on. I remember going into the film thinking, man, I'm gonna dislike the whole Peter Dinklage making Stormbreaker thing as much as it did the first time. And I didn't. I think it's still a little unnecessary. I think that that's one of the places you could have trimmed this film down a little bit. But I do like watching that dynamic unfold. Really, everything with the Guardians and Thor, I think, is great.
Yeah.
From finding him, the whole bit that is so mean-spirited but really funny about Chris Pratt not being the shape he was in when he filmed Guardians, that's all really good. I like the sort of parental stuff with Groot. You're going to rot your brain playing your video games, right?
Playing your Dawn video games.
I told Tanner last night, I think we've had three too many appearances of Teenage Groot, and that's all of his appearances.
Yeah.
But no, I do like that, and I think that it provides heart. And as you're saying, Tucker, there's a good balance here between the hokey, Marvel jokey, quippy stuff and the serious things. And I think a perfect example of that, I don't know how people feel about this joke, but I like it a lot, is when Gamora is explaining to Peter, you're going to have to kill me, right?
Yeah.
One of the best
serious moments in the Guardians ever.
It's an excellent serious moment. And then they start pulling the camera back and they let the camera pull back and leave that emotional moment. And then they do the Drax joke, but there's enough space there that it doesn't feel like one's stepping on the other. Mm-hmm. And then you get a funny Drax bit about him thinking he's invisible eating popcorn. I really like that quite a bit. I think all of that's excellent. The other dynamic that I really love, and I want to hear your guys' thoughts on, is Peter and Tony.
Absolutely.
I think that comes along very nicely and ends in a very good place here, but I've been fucking talking, so somebody tell me about why they like that dynamic.
Just quickly, and I'll let Tucker talk about Tony and Peter. You're wrong about the restarting of the Forge at Nidavellir being able to be cut, because then we wouldn't get that sweet shot of Chris Hemsworth flexing his biceps. So you're wrong there.
Second only to the gratuitous Captain America Civil War flip the bicep grab.
Yeah.
Second best bicep shot in the MCU.
Yes.
And of course, there's a number of them we're going to have to go through. And that's the next show, boys. Just ranking
those. I'd love that.
Shorts. Let's do it.
Okay. We're going to call it Objectifying Men.
Yeah. Yeah.
The new BLB show. Everyone get hyped. Mm-hmm. Peter and Tony, I think, is really the heart of this movie, even if Thor is my favorite character in this film or the one that gives the most growth. Because I do think that, well, I go into this film being like, God, Iron Man, Spider-Man, holy crap. I think that they aren't given the emotional moments on the whole that Thor is, which is why my eyes chewing lock on him when I'm thinking about my favorite parts of this movie. But the fact that this is really the first time that we see their dynamic absolve after the sort of confusion of Homecoming, of, no, you go have the suit, I want the suit, all that fucking shit, we watched Homecoming 10 years ago. It's all lost in my brain. But I really do love the way that they work together here. And each of their moments confirms like things about each of them and within their relationship to each other. And then, of course, there's a monkey wrench in the shape of Stephen Strange thrown in there that I think gives it an even richer dynamic, because it's someone who's not familiar with their previously established dynamic. So, yeah, a great, great part of the movie. And just full of great lines. Oh my god.
I love Peter and his two dads in this movie. I think it's great, and obviously, you know, that is this is the beginning of the passing of the torch, I think. To Tom Holland probably being the figurehead of the MCU, even though it seems like they're maybe trying to make it Stephen Strange, but we all know it's Tom Holland.
I sure to God hope it's not Stephen Strange.
But he's the one that's bringing people into the seats, you know what I mean?
I sure hope it's Wong.
Yeah. Well, based on appearances alone, it seems to be. But, you know, it's the beginning of that passing of the baton. You know, this sets up Tony and Peter's, like, final words to each other in Endgame and stuff like that. And it also sets up, you know, Peter sort of having to switch over to idolizing Stephen Strange in No Way Home, being like, he's the guy I'm going to go to solve my problems.
I'm sure I never thought of it that way.
Yeah.
Good point.
And, I just really love, I love the way that Peter is introduced. You know, we get the Peter tingle, of course, I love that we get that little appearance of Ned when he's like, we're all gonna die, and then Spider-Man swings in, and he stops the big hammer at the last moment. That NYC battle at the beginning is fantastic, by the way. It starts out really ominous when it's like, everything's quiet, what's going on, and then, like, the screaming sort of slowly builds up as Bruce, Tony, Steven, and Wong are like, what's going on? They all go out of the house, and they see the ship in the sky, and they're like, oh, shit, shit's going down.
Yeah, that's the line from the movie.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, I fucking popped my bottle of NyQuil like with a champagne when that Spider-Man theme hits on the bus. I think it's an awesome moment. I really love that entire dynamic, and I think it's funny the ways that in a quote unquote professional context, Peter and Tony play off of each other a little bit. I think the aliens bit is funny as a sort of callback to the really old movie Empire Strikes Back bit.
Yeah.
And then I'm usually not a fan of meta humor, but the whole I don't want to hear the pop culture reference out of you line is quite clever too. In this sort of sense that Tony is training Peter on the job. Okay, what's your plan? What are we going to do? How are we going to figure this out?
You're an Avenger now.
Yeah, that's another really funny moment. I think that all works super well because Tony in this movie is quite fascinating to me because he's everything, all of his anxieties that have been sort of bubbling up this last couple appearances, boom, they're in front of our face now all of a sudden. And he's this guy's got no fucking time. He's got his time to make his jokes and his gaffes and his hoo-haws, but he is here to do business. And I think that tone for him is really, really cool. Like, he's really not taking shit from anybody.
Especially not Thanos, yeah.
Especially not Thanos.
Yeah.
And when he's wailing on Thanos and they're fighting, oh my god, that's great choreography. Mm-hmm. But that sort of like desperation in his eyes as he's like rerouting the nanobots from like his leg up to his arm.
Jesus Christ.
And then he gets stabbed. It's good shit. Mm-hmm. I think Robert Downey Jr. does believe it or not, I think he does a phenomenal job in Infinity War.
Holy crap. Robert Downey Jr. is good as Tony Stark. Revolutionary.
All that for a drop of blood. It's a great line. I love that fucking line. Because it is Tony, like, just going all out. He's like, you know, my anxieties about being the last line of defense for the Earth is going on right now. He is going fucking balls to the walls fighting Thanos in that moment. He is hitting him with everything he can. He is, you know, leaving parts of his body, you know, uncovered by nanobots just in the attempt to stab Thanos with that knife. Which probably wouldn't kill Thanos, but he's trying nonetheless. And I think that's what's important about Tony in this movie.
Okay. All right. We got a couple other things to talk about here. I think where we should lead next to, sort of connecting what we were just talking about, you know, we just had a little break, a little inside baseball, but the action in this film, which I think is across the board fantastic. I don't think there's a single action sequence in here that doesn't feel incredibly deliberate or unique, and I think that's why it stands out so much, is there not only perfectly placed throughout the film of, okay, oh, we got our middle one, we got our end one, but there's like smaller ones peppered throughout, and each one feels so unique that you never feel like you're inundated with action sequences. Of course, this is an action movie, and frankly, I think there's probably more action sequences here, but because they are so different, I'm always on board as soon as we get into some sort of action sequence, and especially just the choreography and use of powers and the way that plays into that dialogue and the character dynamics. I think the action is top tier in this movie.
I would absolutely agree.
I think that most of the action is really good.
Okay.
I want to talk about the Wakanda battle because I just don't like the Wakanda battle, and we can talk about that. Let's put this way. There is parts of the Wakanda battle I really like.
Yeah.
But to me, the choreography succeeds most. I think this is in my head when Infinity War is like a fighting game, and I think it feels a lot like a fighting game in a lot of these conflicts. Sure. They're really interestingly choreographed, and everybody has so many cool fucking moves.
Yeah.
I think that Thanos versus Iron Man fight is probably the most like fighting
game. Everything on Titan. Mm-hmm. Everything on Titan.
They are literally like pulling out supers and pulling out combos and everything. And it is really awesome because it gives all these characters a chance for their powers to shine.
Yeah.
And Tucker, even Mantis. And actually, Tucker, watching this movie, I think, retrospectively, you're more right than I let on about Multiverse of Madness's choreography.
Yes, I thought that too when watching the Titan fight.
Even though I think that movie, the choreography of Multiverse of Madness is still far better than you did, like, what Doctor Strange does here is just a whole other fucking level. Like, everybody was taken to, like, up an entire stratosphere of power. I really, like, the hierarchy of power in the Marvel Cinematic Universe been the same.
No.
But if I could shout out one in particular, I think that maybe my favorite moment in the entire MCU is Captain America standing in the shadows.
Yeah, baby.
As that train's going
yeah,
by.
Baby.
And then that World of Warcraft character throws the spear at him. And he goes, "Whoop." And
yes.
Just that, and his theme hits as the camera like racks in on him. My favorite moment in the entire MCU. I think that he is so fucking cool in this movie.
Fuck yeah.
So that whole fight is probably my favorite, just seeing him and Natasha and Falcon back, all of them fighting.
Yeah.
Is super cool. But pretty much any of the more intimate fights in this movie, I think, are awesome.
Yeah. Which are most of them, frankly.
Most
I mean,
of them.
Really is, well, okay. You say the Titan battle is a weird interplay because that fight is very intimate because there's only one target. Even though there's like 10 people that are involved in that,
yeah.
It's so tightly knit that it ends up feeling, it's not on the scale of something like the Wakanda battle, which I think is really the only exception to
yeah.
the intimate nature of a lot of these battles. And it is the Wakanda battle that I think is the low light of this movie, and I think you and I will probably agree on that, Abram. But it's filled with so many specific moments that I love that it's sort
yeah.
of like the sum is lesser than its parts, but also I don't give a fuck because like each of its parts is so great that like whatever. But it is a weird balance. I agree.
Sorry. Go ahead, Abram.
Abram, the reason I use intimate even for Titan is because there aren't a million faceless guys pulled from
mm-hmm.
them. They're like Destiny Thrall is what they are. Just running at the gate and doing the whole like fucking immolation thing and the gate opens. I just think that like that to me is a level of CGI clusterfuck that I think is just ridiculous.
Yeah.
But as you're saying, Tucker, I think you're totally right in that the fodder gives people the opportunity to do cool shit.
Yeah.
I love Rocket and fucking
Bucky
Wolf. What do they call him? The
White Wolf.
The Wicked Wolf or whatever. The White Wolf.
Yeah.
Wolf of the West.
I like that a lot. I think it's actually been more visually stunning than the shot in Ragnarok. But Thor coming back with Stormbreaker for the first time there is crazy. I think that's really cool. And then the fight against, again, the Thanos is one of his fucking goblin people with Okoye. And Okoye is such a badass in this movie. We don't see a whole lot of Okoye, but she's so fucking cool. When they're fighting in the trench, and then Scarlet Witch just goes, oh, foot, into Grievous's wheel bike. I think that's so good. So again, yeah, you're right, Tucker. There are really cool moments, but that to me is where the CGI both gets worse, like in the Hulkbuster stuff, which is
yes.
beaten into the ground of how bad it is.
Uh-huh.
But just, I think, like, the scale of CGI nonsense I didn't like, but I love T'Challa yelling Wakanda forever, and he's hyping up all the troops and everything.
Him and Cap racing.
Hell yeah.
God, do
yeah.
that jump.
Yeah, yeah.
Any specific Wakanda battle moments that you want to point out here?
Let's see here. Abram pointed out the, why was she not here this whole time? I love that. Let's see. I mean, obviously, I have to mention Thor showing up with Stormbreaker. You know, I'm a fence sitter on whether or not they should have used the Avengers theme there or Immigrant Song there. I could go either way, quite frankly, because it's super dope as it is. But it would also be even more super dope maybe if they used Immigrant Song. But yeah, I love what the lead up to that too is that you know they're beating down all these like rabid dog alien things or whatever, but they get overwhelmed and then Thor shows up. Actually, one that I will say is when they realize they have to let them in the dome.
Yeah,
he's like, we're gonna get surrounded. What are we gonna do? He's like, we open section 17C. He's like, did you just say open the barrier? He's
yeah.
like, hell yeah, buddy. And then Rhodey comes in. He's just fucking. He fucking. What's the word I'm looking for? He just
carpet bombs
a whole ton of them. That's
yeah.
dope. I love that.
Yeah.
yeah,
I mean, and especially because I think it ends in a more intimate way. I think that
yeah.
as soon as you transition to the forest, it's a lot less CGI clusterfucky.
Mm-hmm.
It's a lot more visually contained, and it feels a lot more intimate. I can take or leave a couple of the moments with the Black Order in the forest, but I do think there are a handful of good moments. Like, what are you pogging at?
Is that a reference to Marvel Ultimate Alliance 3?
God damn it. I wag my finger at you in general direction, buddy. No, it's the other way around. Jesus Christ. But the moment when Bruce has to use the Hulkbuster to take call Obsidian.
That's the one.
And just absolutely demolish him in the top of the shield. And everything with Thanos in the forest, I think, is great because it really just shows almost all of the characters just getting knocked the fuck out.
Yeah, he's just batting them aside. He's putting fucking Bruce in like a stone wall. He clocks Steve Rogers the hardest that ever had a right hook to the head. It's insane that man is still alive.
Yeah.
Well, as soon as that happened, I'm like, God, he's going to have a headache.
Yeah.
Well, Tucker, when you said Hulkbuster and pointed, if you had let that hang a second longer, I thought you were waiting for me to say, I hardly know her, but you were. But I also really do love that forest fight. And Steve Rogers thing, I think it's cool, sort of a little bit of a foreshadow to the whole picking up Mjolnir worthy thing, right? Mm-hmm. When like he grabs Thanos's hand holds him, and Thanos is like, what the fuck, how is he doing this? I think that's a cool moment. And again, it goes back to that desperation. I think that the film is so desperate in that respect.
Yeah.
Just all of these heroes you love getting turned into just like shapes and shit. Like back when we're on Nowhere and we turn
Nowhere fight, also great.
Mm-hmm.
We turn
Drax into cubes.
We turn Drax into cubes and we turn fucking Mantis into like an arms character. I think that's all great. But if we can stick in the forest for a second,
uh-huh.
I want to talk about the end of the film, if we can, if you'll oblige me.
I'll allow that.
Now, this is another point where we have to go back and talk about younger Abram for a moment.
Okay.
Because one of my major...
How much younger? 10 minutes? 2 hours?
Mm-hmm. 3 months old.
3 months, yeah. when I saw Infinity War for the first time, I remember thinking, this is horse shit, because they're all coming back, and it's exploitation of my emotions in X and Y and W, right?
Uh-huh.
I don't really feel the same way on a rewatch. And the reason being is I think just because I'm less cynical on Marvel as a whole, I think that UMP has made me less cynical towards the franchise overall. But
that's good.
Also, I think that there's
that's
just
why
a
we did this.
Uh-huh.
There's just our master
plan. To trick Abram into liking Marvel movies more.
I think that there's just a really smart artistic contrast to having no music and just a lot of these really like spooky wide shots.
Yeah.
Of just people standing up. And what's cool about it is that not everybody fades away at the same pace.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you think for a second, like Black Panther goes to Okoye and is like, get up, this isn't a place to die. And then he fades away.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's just so effective and haunting how they really take the time to drink in everybody's disappearance.
Yeah.
And then, I mean, obviously the whole Mr. Stark, I'm not feeling good thing.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that line in particular is quite as emotional as other people do because it does move pretty quickly.
I think it's because it's been memed into the ground,
right?
Frankly.
It could be that, but I do.
Well,
think
I really relate to him because I don't feel well either.
I don't either. That's a great point. I was actually muttering that in my sleep last night, but I think that it's a really effective way to show how far our heroes have fallen.
Yeah.
Directly into Thanos, another memed moment, stepping out of his house. And then directed by Joe Anthony Russo.
Yeah.
Like, mm-hmm. I don't think, for my taste, this movie could have ended any better. Like, I couldn't, in a fantasy world, come up with a better ending for the film.
Absolutely not. And I think that the interesting thing about the ending of this film, I think the ending of this film is the interesting part of this movie. I think that is not only why this movie was created, like, it has such an interesting concept to it. Like, no other blockbuster on this scale has ever been put to screen with this amount of money and this amount of people that just it loses and it's sad at the end and everyone's dead and just like fuck you, directed by Joe Anthony Russo. Like, it feels like a really powerful statement, and also I really do think that as our generation grows older, we start making movies, we start being the ones that are the center of like these are the great film moments. I think that the emotional resonance of building up all these characters over a decade's worth of film and then just leaving us for an entire year of who knows what's going to happen, and killing off half the characters and leaving just the stragglers left behind. I think it's easily the most powerful emotional moment I've ever witnessed in a theater. I mean, there are a few that are up there as well, but just I don't think I've ever heard more people cry in a theater.
Openly
watching.
Weeping. Yes.
Absolutely. I mean, me and my friend just sitting there, just like everyone sniffling, like just moments of cinema that stick with you.
Yeah.
And the stakes of this film are something that I hear a lot of people like sort of, oh, well, especially when it was coming out, it's like, oh, we know they're coming back. So there's no stakes. But you have to put yourself in the mind of one of the surviving people in this film. What do you mean there's no stakes? They don't know what's going to happen. They just saw all their friends die. On a personal and emotional moment, this is the most impactful thing that has ever happened, maybe ever will happen in the MCU. And from that, like, that is stakes, in my opinion, the way that it impacts everyone involved.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, that is always a silly critique to me, as well as, like, oh, obviously they're going to come back, because that thought occurred to me, obviously, in the theater. But, yeah, you can predict, like, you can do that with literally any film ever, and if you don't connect with the characters, fine, you know, well enough, I understand if you're going to be cynical about it, but that's the strength of this movie. I mean, we circle back to what we sort of opened this discussion talking about, is the bringing of together of all these characters, the characters that people have grown to love over the last 10 years, 18 films. And it is a cultural moment. I mean, I don't think that's an understatement, right? A massive cultural moment for people.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, you know, as usual, the best transmedia franchise ever exists, Star Wars. It's right at Empire Strikes Back. And I just think it's a really effective...
I shouldn't have raised my fan to that. What the fuck am I doing?
I think it's just a really effective thing to say, you know what? We're a franchise that is largely predicated on formulaic storytelling, but this time we're just going to kind of go left when you think we're going to go right. Because there are so many moments to the less engaged viewer of, like, oh, but this is where they beat Thanos in that last second, right? You know, but Scarlet Witch is going to hold him off just long enough to break the Mind Stone, right? Yeah. And then the movie's going to end with the tragedy of Vision's death, but at least they're going to have to defeat Thanos. Or, oh, but yes, and here comes Stormbreaker. You should have gone for the head. Great moment.
Yeah.
Like they really do, I think, to the last second, subvert any last hope you might have as an audience member that's going to be fine. The only thing that the end of the film's missing is Linkin Park, but you can't get everything right.
Yeah, someone sent that meme, I think, today in our group chat. Yeah. God damn it. No, but I also do want to say that I think one of the other reasons why this film is above some of the other ones in the MCU is I think this film is a lot more visually interesting than a lot of Marvel movies. I think that it's not the greatest color palette, especially when they're on Earth, when they're in Wakanda, but there is a lot of deliberate framing and incredible use of CGI spectacle in this film that legitimately wows me to this day, having seen the film 7 times. That shot of Vormir with a mountain and these crazy clouds and the, like, sand dunes in the front, but it's all, like, lit backlit by, like, white and purple. It's really visually interesting, and all of these moments just, like, stick out to me, like, okay, no, there was a lot of thought put into the visual choices in this film.
Yeah. Tucker, I think you're totally right. I just think it's funny that the examples you went to are mountains and clouds.
Yeah, but the cool mountains and clouds.
No, you're totally right. But, like, when I think of the success of this film, I think about the way that they're able to use CGI to bring these characters' worlds to life in a way that's believable.
Okay, fine. That... What about Titan? What about that first shot of Titan and, like, these weird, like, star-shaped buildings that are crumbled down and, like, it looks like
that's what
photorealistic.
I think of. That's what I think of. That's just why I think it's funny that it's like things that the thing I see when I look out my window is what you think of as visually interesting in the movie. But because I think about Titan, I think that's a great example. And the brilliant shots of the time stone giving these illusions of reality in the ways that they designed the geography of the world to so easily segue between two completely different time periods.
Yeah.
It's like pre and post destruction. I think that's really beautiful, and it's really inspired, and that's the sort of stuff that I kind of wish people recognized more in Marvel films. Yeah, the film is often flat, but there's a lot of really interesting creative choices that go into just sort of how the worlds are shaped.
Yeah,
and I think this film is a great example of it, and it's a great example of what Marvel can look like when they give it the fucking budget and they give the VFX people time to really do their work right.
Yeah.
Although I am also really finding it funny, all the names of VFX workers programming, like She-Hulk twerking. I think that's really funny on Twitter right now.
Yes.
But this film, I do think, you're right, Tucker, is a visual spectacle.
Mm-hmm. It's a visual marvel.
Nice. Very good. I'm just gonna one perfect shot the shot of Tony after Peter completely dusts away, and he's just kind of there, like, he's holding his hand. I think that's a very well-composed shot. It's probably one of the most visually striking, like, single-frame moments that people have of this film, for sure. Mm-hmm. And it also looks like he's sort of tasting what the dust feels like. Or tastes like. Just a little bit.
Anything else you guys want to segue into? Because I still have one more thing I want to talk about. Of course, we have a couple other characters we might want to talk about, yes or no?
No. Oh, his thing, like, there are more characters in the film. This, you're not
What?
lying. But I do think this is where the film begins to feel a little bit overstuffed for me. Like, I think about Nebula. I think the relationship between Gamora and Nebula and Thanos is obviously so important. But it feels like it's in this, it's like in the fucking in like the fucking gully between like having there's both too much and not enough of this relationship, I think. Like, Nebula is just kinda, she was doing a really cool thing. She's trying to go assassinate Thanos. You would think we would see that, you know? We just kind of see her and she's kind of strung up.
Oh, sure.
And then we don't see her, and then she crashes into Thanos. And then she fights Thanos, and then she kind of disappears again, right? I mean, the relationship between Gamora and Nebula is so central to their arcs as they develop across the movies that I think either include it or don't include it, but I do feel like 2.5 hours for this film is a little bit much. Like, if we could get this down to like 2:15 or 2:10 or 2:05 or 2 or 1:55.
What about a tight 90?
I just think that you could have trimmed a little bit out of this film.
Yeah, I mean, I don't necessarily know if I agree with that because I do think that the film is paced very well. I think that what
Sure.
Tanner started with and is I think one of the greatest strengths of this film is that when you'll leave one of the sets of groups for a long time, like
Yeah.
20, 25 minutes sometimes. But as soon as you cut back, you never feel like you've missed something with
Sure.
them to a certain to varying degrees, but I never think to its detriment. And you're always excited and interested to see what happens when you come back. You're like, oh man, I missed this. This is really cool. Can't wait to see what's happening. And because of that, there never feels like there's a low moment of dullness in this film. And that's why I would say I don't think that things necessarily could have been cut because every film does feel like a building block to multiple towers. I think that's what's interesting about this film is it is building up quite a few different amounts of things that are happening, and they're not necessarily all in the same, like Thanos is kind of the roof, but then you've got multiple pillars that I think each have such important building blocks that I really don't know what could have cut. Maybe some efficiency, maybe some retooling of some minor character arcs, but on the whole, I don't think this film could have been shorter and done justice to the amount of characters that are shown. Because I think as soon as you start cutting 15, 20 minutes, then any single character moment that you're missing, you're like, oh, well, I really wish we'd gotten more from Natasha. She doesn't have very
Sure.
much to do in this film, but the fact that she does have some to do in this film is important to her feeling like a part of the ensemble.
Yeah, no,
Yeah.
I think that's fair. I mean, maybe my complaint is more that I wish it was either less or more, because I think you could have done more. I think
Yeah, absolutely.
if Endgame's 3 hours, right?
Yeah.
I think you could have done 3 hours here, because I think about, like, it's cool. As I said, I love when Cap and Natasha and Falcon come back, but then they show up and Thunderbolt Ross is like, I'm gonna court martial you, and then Rhodey says, "Nuts to that," and basically the conflict of Civil War is erased. Now I get that it's
Yeah.
sort of like a, "Hey, this is more important. We're putting that aside because the stakes are much higher now," but nonetheless, it feels like a little. There's a little bit of an erasure of sort of like some of the interpersonal conflicts that are quite interesting from Civil War that never quite get played out. So maybe
Yeah.
I would. Maybe my criticism would also be addressed by 20 more minutes of footage.
Yeah, absolutely.
But 20 more
Tucker.
minutes of footage, I should just scratch it.
Tucker,
I get it.
please hit us with your last point.
My last point, I think, is where I sort of started my discussion of this film, which is the interconnected storytelling of the MCU. And for me, this, alongside something like Endgame and like Civil War, of course, these are the three big culminations that we've had so far. This feeling like the one where it's really realized some of its best is there's such a sense of continuity to each element of this film. And I really don't know, like, I haven't sat down and fucking gone beat for beat of okay, Wong, Nebula, Groot. Like, I haven't gone through and been like, okay, this makes a lot of sense. But when you're thinking about each moment that they've set up in these previous films, it really feels like nothing is left untouched in this film. Even down to something like what happened to Red Skull after the events of First Avenger. Okay, he was sucked to Vormir. That's an answer to that. An answer that Tanner says people were asking, but I never fucking heard of, I never thought of. But then they're like, okay, this is a connection back to one of the first things that happened in the MCU. And continuing things like the post credit, or not the post credits, but one of the ending things of Homecoming is Tony and Pepper getting engaged. Okay, and we're talking about that a little bit, and that influences Tony's decision-making near the beginning of the film, or that Wanda and Vision have been building up this relationship over the course of Civil War, and now they're stealing moments together, but they're from these divided factions, and there's lines that are referencing this, and the secret Avengers of Sam and Nat and Steve that are like operating the background. Like, there's such a sense that they knew where everyone was at the end of their last appearance, and that we're seeing where they're continuing here. And yes, there are moments or things like Nebula going to assassinate Thanos that we don't see, but those elements are so few and far between that I just end up impressed. Even when we have, like, you know, we had this problem with Suicide Squad. There's so many starts to this movie because you got to introduce Wanda and Vision, and you got to introduce Tony and Steve. You got to introduce Peter. You got to, like, down the line. But each of them feels like we're picking up at a perfect moment, and they all synergize in such interesting ways that I'm always just like, oh, wow, this was handled beautifully.
Yeah. It is rewarding to the audience. It is rewarding to the audience for keeping up with these characters, keeping up with these films. And I think that is, you know, that's what people dig the MCU is, because it's all interconnected and interwoven, except when it isn't, of course. But even then, sometimes it is. You know, pull up a new Rockstar's Easter eggs video, whatever you want to do, you know what I mean? I think that is, you know, that's why Infinity War and Endgame were such big deals. They were the payoff. They were the reward for the audience for keeping up with these movies for 10, 11 years. And then I think, you know, this is getting a little conversational about, like, the state of the MCU, but I think people are maybe a little itchy for that again, because we are diversifying so much into film and TV.
Yeah.
I think people are a little itchy for that again, but of course, you know, you just got to be patient. We know that Avengers Secret Wars and the Kang Dynasty is coming in 2025 or whatever, both in the same year, still insane, but yeah, whatever.
We'll see if that actually happens.
Yeah, we'll see.
No, I think you're totally right, and there are these toys called Marvel Legends. I'm sure pretty much anyone watching this is familiar with them. And, like, each toy comes with a piece of another figure. And if you buy, like, the whole wave, you get all the pieces to, like, assemble the Hulkbuster or assemble Thanos or whatever, right? And it really does feel like that sort of payoff for being dedicated to this world is the same here. You're taking this piece that you got from Guardians and this piece you got from First Avenger, and you have the satisfaction of putting it all together. And I think that's really great. And what I really appreciate about it is that in films that are dumbed down, I think it's too pejorative, but when you're making a four-quadrant, $2 billion blockbuster, you're here to speak to, and I this is not a pejorative.
I want to be clear, none of these films cost $2 billion.
No, sorry, a $2 billion grossing film.
Okay.
Yeah.
Which it did grow. This one made $2 billion, right? It doesn't matter.
Come on, box office, man.
It made a fucking acre of money, right? You could fill an acre.
Oh, it did. Just barely correct.
Right.
Yeah.
But what I'm trying to say is, when you're making this for so many people, you have to appeal to the lowest common denominator. And I don't mean that in a pejorative way. Yes, I mean that in a pejorative way. But like, they trusted the audience enough to come into Infinity War with the requisite information. Mm-hmm. Yeah. There is not a whole lot of time spent explaining shit. No. I mean, they throw you right in with that stuff with Heimdall and Loki and everybody.
Two of the most brutal deaths of the MCU.
They're really good. And they just expect you to understand it. And I really appreciate that, especially after something like Love and Thunder, which I was somewhat off put by how much time we spent reiterating the previous Thor films. Mm. The fact that Joe and Anthony Russo were like, look, this is a movie made for the people who have seen these Marvel movies.
Yeah.
We don't need to come in here and tell them what's going on. Mm-hmm. I think that gave him a lot of room to play and just make something fulfilling. I think rewarding is a great word, Tanner. I do wish some of it was taken a little bit further. Like, for a second, we get the Bruce and Natasha meet again for a second. Yeah. And then that never goes anywhere, right? There are things that we get close to paying off but don't have time for.
Yeah.
So the more I think about it, maybe my complaint is that this movie isn't 3 hours. But nonetheless, I think that it is a really impressive achievement and a real level of, I think, trust in the audience to just let it unfold and let you understand or not understand.
Yeah, well, I think the interesting part about that is you're absolutely right. Though, this movie still does have exposition dumps. It is Thanos giving his monologue to the slaughtered Asgardians, and it's dialogue that's like, okay, here's my goal. Here's what happened at the end of Ragnarok. But it's done in such a compelling way that it never feels like an exposition dump. Or, and I think the real masterclass moment is, you know where Bruce has been for the last 5 years? He's been off in Sakaar. He's been dicking around Asgard, all that crap. He doesn't know that Civil War happened. So having Tony be like, yeah, the Avengers broke up. And then, like, light explanations of this is sort of what happens to Sokovia Accords, all that. It because it's the characters talking in a believable way, because it's played into this dynamic of the fact that Bruce has been missing and has missed Nat and didn't know there was this conflict, it feels like, yeah, of course they would explain this to him. It is an exposition dump, but it's done so masterfully through the dialogue and in-world connotation that I really feel like it's a strength of this film to... I have no idea. If you came in with this with no knowledge, how much you'd be able to piece together? Probably very fucking little. But there is, I think, enough to sort of like refresh your memory of this is what happened, this is where people were, and get you caught up to speed that the film makes sense in its own without having to have just watched all the movies.
Yeah, I think you're totally right. I want to quickly point out one callback before we end the episode. My favorite callback, one of my favorite jokes in the movie, is when they're explaining Earth's Mightiest Heroes to Avengers, and then Manta goes, like, Kevin Bacon? Mm-hmm. I think that's a really good callback. That's all I really had to say.
He may or may not be on the team. I haven't been there a while.
Yeah. Nowhere near as thoughtful as what you had to contribute, Tucker. I just wanted to shut that up before I forgot it.
Yeah. What about the who is Gamora, where is Gamora, why is Gamora?
Love that. Okay. Everything with Tony and Peter Quill, I think, is just golden. And this is really the only time we ever see them interact, but I think that's fine. I think, like, the comedic value of, what am I supposed to say, Jesus, where are you from, Earth?
No, I'm Jesus.
From, no, I'm from Missouri. That's on funny, Earth, too. Dipshit. Or Drax yawning, Mr. Clean, get over here.
Don't call us plucky. We don't know what that means.
Or I'm half human, that's 100% you. Math is fucking boggling my mind. Mm-hmm. There's so many, I think this is one of the funniest Marvel movies. Mm-hmm. And every line is frankly iconic. I think it's impressive how much of this film has been memes, but not for, oh, this is stupid meme. It's like, oh, this is interesting. Oh, this means something. We all understand this because we watched this movie. It was a cultural moment. And each of these lines, basically everything Thanos says, is just like, you can do some sort of meme. But I think for the right reasons, and not for the, I think, other in competition for most meme movies like Star Wars Episode 3 or Spider-Man 3. These are memed for not the greatest reasons. But I think this movie is memed for the great reasons of it just being absolutely iconic.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Fellas, can we give this film a score?
Can give this film a score.
Dust off that spreadsheet. Let's crack it open. Like an ancient tome.
Crack it up in a cold one with the boys.
Crack it open a Google spreadsheet with the boys.
A spreadsheet with the boys.
Oh, Abram, did you change it to MCU ranking?
Oh, he did.
I heard that on Twitter for the first time today, and I thought that was so funny.
Are you
funny.
Fucking serious? You've never heard MCU before?
No. Is that something, like, I'm assuming that's what people are saying, we're, like, trying to make fun of the MCU
for
being
feminist,
woke.
Feminist wokeism.
That started with Infinity War, actually. I mean, it obviously got played up in a... Because the girl power moment of Okoye, Black Widow, and Scarlet Witch.
Are you fucking kidding me?
I'm not joking with you.
See, this is what happens when you make when you make movies for everything. The actual mouth breathers who aren't mouth breathing because their nose is stuffed up come out and they start trying to enjoy the fucking movie. Shut up. Mm-hmm. I'm tired of all these fucking bigots talking about Marvel. That She-Hulk, by the way, She-Hulk, the original run, is sexy and weird, so shut the fuck up about that. that Megan Thee Stallion thing is funny.
What has Marvel done that used to be fun and serious? Oh my god. Remember, shut the fuck up. Remember in Guardians of the Galaxy when Peter Quill did a dance battle at the end of the movie against the villain? Shut up.
God. All right.
Anyway, score for numbers. The movie. Let's count it down. 3, 2, 1. Alrighty then, let's run this down here real quick. Let's go from bottom to top here. I am at the bottom, as I often am. I don't know what it is. Nope. I don't know.
Untrue.
Freudian moment. Yeah. That's a sex moment. Tanner,
I'm on the
joke.
Bottom of this big old boy dog pile here with a 9.4. Abram is next with a 9.7, and Tucker gave this film a perfect 10 out of 10.
Yeah.
That averages out. Oh, sorry, Abram. Go ahead, Abram.
I was just going to say that about my score here for a second.
Yeah.
I do have criticism of the film. I do think that Thanos' motivation is goofy. I do wish there's a little bit more screen time to play some things out. But ultimately, first of all, my scores are always arbitrary. Sorry to the people who put a lot of sanctity into the numbers I give on any of these shows. But as a ratio of coolness to uncoolness,
yeah,
the coolness is just so fucking far and it's beyond off the rest. That like the ratio of good to bad in this movie, I think, is just so strong.
Yeah,
this to me, while it's not my favorite Marvel movie, I think I might consider it the pinnacle of the MCU.
Yeah, I don't think you're alone, Abram. Regardless, though, that's gonna place this film. You know, thankfully, I don't have to figure out where it ranks. With my COVID brain, because it's going straight to the top, baby. That's a number one with an average of a 9.7. God. Above Guardians of the Galaxy, dethroning Guardians of the Galaxy as the best film, the pinnacle of the MCU, as Abram just said.
Which got here on our list a 9.566666 repeating 7. I didn't know it did the decimal points.
Yes, it did. But thank you, folks, for joining us. We were dusting up the cobwebs in this episode. Thank you for sticking with it. It was a long one, but, you know, it had to be, you know, because Avengers Infinity War is a big honking deal. Next week, we'll be talking about, or next time, no promises, one of us could pass away from one of the various illnesses we've contracted. Next time, we will be talking about Ant-Man and the Wasp, a film that's, you know, sort of denigrated in the annals of the MCU. You know, the follow-up to Infinity War, people were like, Ant-Man and the Wasp, not so great. We'll be the true judges of that
That's our job.
On the Untitled Backlog Marvel Banter Project, which is a show that is done at Backlog Banter. Thank you very much, everyone. We'll see you next time.
Hey, boys, can you tell we're out of practice?
Yeah. It also doesn't help that two out of three of us are sick.
No, that's certainly true. Yeah.
I think this has been a hoot.